You are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's own people. In order that you may proclaim the mighty acts of Him who called you out of darkness into His marvelous light. Chosen, royal, holy. These are pretty strong adjectives for the church. You, like me, are well aware of all of the church's blemishes. At our worst, we are simply a gathering of people with profound problems. But at our best, we are a gathering of those who have the power to absolutely transform the world. It is that mirror that I wish to hold in front of you today. Because every Christian has two sides to his or her redeemed identity. First, the child of God deals with an interior faith. This is where we wrestle with the deep issues of prayerfulness and faith and repentance, personal conduct, custody of our eyes, learning to think on holy things. But the other side, the outward and the incarnational faith, deals with how each individual Christian can work to change the world in which we live. And that is a daunting task. First, many of us never get past the interior battle to feel as though we really have something to offer the wider world. We wrestle with how we can fit in a world around us that is so sinful and so broken. But today, using the words of Peter, we find our place in the world and learn to live not just an inward faith, but an outward faith. Peter writes in his first epistle one of the most profound definitions of what the church really is. A chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's own people. These four things. And we who lived in a time when the church was the big moving and shaking force in society would naturally nod our heads. Yeah, that's the way it's supposed to be. But we no longer live in a uniquely Christian or Christian culture. In fact, it's become less and less so. When I look back to what was the thing that really changed? When was it that it seemed as though the society started its slip toward a postmodern identity? When was it that the church began to lose its influence? I really come back to the date, November 22nd, 1963. And it is at that point as though the blinders of how we perceived our society changed forever when the president was assassinated in Dallas. Our world would not be the same. We would not view the world the same, either inside or outside the church. Even though in those days, about 40% of all people were attending a house of worship for a weekend service, whether it be Christian or Jewish, or otherwise. Now, it should be of some comfort, though, that Peter writes his letter at a time when Christians had even less standing than they do now. The author of the letter to the Hebrews writes about this very same bedraggled church that Peter is addressing. And here, from Hebrews chapter 11, for those of you in St. Mary's Bible study, you should be getting very familiar with this chapter, because this is where we pick back up. These, through faith, conquered kingdoms, administered justice, obtained promises, shut the mouths of lions, quenched raging fire, escaped the edge of the sword, won strength out of weakness, became mighty in war, put foreign armies to flight. Women received their dead by resurrection. Others were tortured, refusing to accept release in order to obtain a better resurrection. Others suffered mocking and flogging, chains and imprisonment. They were stoned to death, sawn in two, killed by the sword, went about in the skins of sheep and goats, destitute, persecuted, tormented. Of whom, check this, the world was not worthy. Wandering in deserts and mountains, in caves and holes in the ground. So it's to those verses that I challenge the television preachers of today, who don't seem to get that this really is a struggle. We don't make one confession of Christ and suddenly our life miraculously transforms to where everything's absolutely fabulous. Doesn't work that way. This is a fight. And we're called a church militant for a reason. Our outward walk is not easy. We may have had it a little bit easy for a while in that wonderful golden age of planting the churches and establishing churches in America from about 1920 to 1963. But it is no longer the case. And the postmodern church of today is really a shadowy reflection of the very same church that we can look to the pages of the Acts of the Apostles to find exactly how it is that we are to function in the here and now. Which leads me to the purpose of Peter's writing. He writes to give us hope. Hope. Precious truth for hurting people. People in persecution need to know that what they are doing is of value. Here we find that the church's identity is in the midst of suffering, a persecuted minority. Take heart. Peter tells us, some around you rejected Christ, and they stumble in disobedience. But you who are, as Paul says, in Christ, receive him and make him the cornerstone of your being. There is a euphemism for adopted children. We often refer to them as chosen children. This refers to the fact that although they do not share any DNA with their parents, they are every bit as much a part of the family, because they were actively sought out and intentionally made by an act of law a part of the family. Peter, acknowledging that in our common confession of faith and our common baptism, we really are part of one big adoptive family. When we look around us, although we may see our families of origin, what we really are looking at in the resurrection world is our brothers and sisters. Now let's contrast that to the distinctions that were among the Pharisees of the day. Your standing was rooted in your family of origin. This is why we have these long lists of genealogies of the Old Testament, and even in two of the Gospels. If you were born of Jews, you're considered special. In the New Covenant, though, all of these distinctions, all of these family of origin issues are blotted out, no longer of any consequence whatsoever. Because our new race, our new specialness, our new identity is found in the waters of baptism, with which we are adopted into one family, not from a myriad of other families. We're a royal priesthood. This is because we are adopted by God in baptism, and so we are all then made heirs of the King of Kings. We are all, get this, we are all priests of a sort. Now what does that mean? It does not mean in the ecclesiastical sense that we all have a sacramental calling, but it means in the Old Testament sense of priesthood that we all have equal access to God. We who believe and are baptized all have the same standing. Therefore, your prayers are no more or no less efficacious than mine or anybody else's. God sees us all on the same strata, all of his sons and daughters. We are citizens of a kingdom, not by birth, not by actions of human effort, but because God loved us into the kingdom. And that action is God's, not ours. This holy nation that Peter calls us exists on every continent, in every nation, in all the palaces and slums of the world. It's everywhere. And at the same time, All of our human governments fail to even recognize it exists. But that's okay, because it's the only kingdom that really matters. It's the only kingdom that lasts to the very, very end. So for those who believe and are baptized, we find that our chosenness and our specialness is not owing to anything special in us, and yet we are who God proclaims us to be. Out of every, get this, out of the words of John, Revelation, we are out of every people, every language, every tongue, every nation, a kingdom of priests who serve our God. All the distinctions of the old life are gone. Today, I am going to share an open secret. It's proclaimed in every liturgy. It's espoused in every creed, and it is said out of every catechism. It's an empowering message that we call mission. You are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's own people. In order that you may proclaim the mighty acts of Him who called you out of darkness and into His light. Our job is not to rest on our specialness. The old days when we used to refer to the Episcopal Church as being God's frozen chosen, back before the 1940s, they called it the Republican Party of Prayer. All of these wonderful old kind of things are no longer fitting us. And that's okay. Because the one thing that really does fit us is we are God's own people. And that's ultimately what matters. Our job is not to rest in anything that we are, but to rest in that relationship that we have with our living and loving God. God's race, priesthood, and nation is meant to always be as it was at Pentecost, an ever-expanding one. And it's one where you come in and where you're the agents of adopting new ones. Every time you feed the hungry and show them the compassionate face of Jesus, you are a chosen race. Every time that God leads you to pray with another person, I know Episcopalians don't like to pray out loud and not from the prayer book, but guess what? Y'all can do it. Every time you do that, you are a holy priesthood. Every time that you acknowledge the one government that really matters is the Lordship of Jesus, then you show that we are a holy nation. Chosen, royal, and holy. God's own people. Truly, those are strong words for the church. And however blemished or however struggling we may be, we push on. Because there is a whole world out there that is depending on St. Stephen's in Little Grand Island to change the world one person at a time. Chosen, royal, and holy is exactly